To become the best cyclist that you can be and hit numbers on the bike that you haven't reached before, adding at-home strength work may just be the most valuable thing you can do. But what does strength work actually look like? And more importantly, what kinds of benefits are you going to get from it? In today's video, 6 exercises every cyclist can do to improve their stability, their power output, and their outright cycling performance with strength and conditioning coach Chris Peden. Chris is a former physical training instructor in the Royal Navy and holds a master's degree in strength, conditioning, and rehabilitation from the University of Portsmouth, UK. He now works with cyclists of all abilities, from professionals through to amateurs like you and I. And in this video, he's going to guide us through a number of simple but effective strength exercises that you can do at home with no gym equipment at all. Before we get into the exercises, I'm going to ask Chris a few questions about the benefits of strength training, along with how often cyclists should do this kind of training, and also when they're going to know that they can add weights into the training as well. If you'd like to see more about Chris and the kinds of training he teaches, you can follow him on Instagram at Combined Athletic Performance. And for the moment, let's get into it. Alrighty, welcome to today's episode of Tristan Take Video. Today I'm in the Science of Sport lab here in the center of Girona, and I'm speaking with Chris Peden, who is a strength and conditioning coach, coaching some of the best riders in the world to help them out at the gym to improve their cycling. Now today we're talking through 6 different gym exercises that every cyclist can do. We have started at a more beginner range, but these are some body weight or slightly weighted exercises that you can do to help improve your cycling, to help form some functional strength and things like that. So let me just start out, before we get into what the exercises are, can you just tell these guys, what do you think are the main benefits of people going to the gym and utilizing a gym to improve their cycling is?
Key thing is, I think with obviously cycling, we understand we're trying to produce a certain amount of power, or people are looking at producing a certain amount of power through the pedals to go faster. So how can we get someone to be able to produce more force, but also how can we get someone more stable on the bike to resist the forces that they're putting through the pedals coming back through the body, so they can ride for longer, more comfortable, produce more power, go faster, recover better as well. So regardless of age, there's going to be some benefits there around performance and then their well-being off the bike as well.
It's probably also fair to say that there's a certain amount of injury prevention that comes with gym work as well, right?
100%, yeah. Like, cyclists are typically a hot mess for overuse injuries because we're just in one fixed position. It's a very, very repetitive natured sport. So the nature of that, we want to kind of make the body more resilient and more robust to those injuries, you know, typically around the knees, hips, ankles. So how can we make all the connective tissues capable of withstanding that repetitive nature and withstanding the forces that we're trying to put through and those pedals as we ride our bikes?
Obviously, as I mentioned, we're doing a lot of these just body weight only to begin with as a nice kind of introduction.
Yeah.
How would you then recommend when people will know that they can start introducing weights into these sessions or into these exercises?
From a body weight perspective, starting there is completely fine, and it will help you start to get stronger, but you will adapt like very quickly. Just like when you first ride a bike, you can go out and do an hour, before you know it, you can do 90 minutes, 2 hours, etc. So you just get used to that load tolerance of what you're doing. So within a couple of weeks, you will start to feel that exercises will feel easier naturally. You will feel that you are recovering from those sessions a lot quicker. So even in that sense, we know then, okay, you are used to this tolerance of load and the stress that you're putting into your system. Okay, how do we continue to progress you, either via load or how do we advance those exercises as well? Initially, if time permits, we ideally want someone to be committing to 2 sessions a week, when and where possible. That might be dependent of where you are in your calendar year of your training. So I have a philosophy of 2 when possible, 1 as much as possible, and then if we have to take a break, then how soon and how quick can we get that session back into the program?
So 2 seems like a good starting point. No more than 2, sufficient amount of recovery in between.
Yeah, 100%. I think especially when you're a beginner, and even when you start becoming more advanced, trying to squeeze that 3rd session in, I think it doesn't allow for enough recovery between those sessions. And we have to always have the bike in mind. The bike is the primary goal and focus. We're trying to support that and support the performance of the bike. We're not trying to take over from it. So if we're trying to condense sessions in too quickly, we're probably not going to recover from them efficiently, which means then the quality of 1 or 2 sessions is going to be suboptimal and obviously then it's going to impact you riding the bike as well, because you're going to be too sore to ride the bike.
Awesome. All right, this is all really good starting info. We may as well just launch into the exercises. What have you got for our first exercise in the gym?
First exercise is a split squat. Static split squat would be just taking a stride out to the front, imagining your feet are on two train tracks rather than one single line so that we can maintain as stable as possible. We're going to control that lowering until our knee lightly taps the floor, and then we're going to try and stand as explosively as possible on the way up. And then we're going to repeat that for 8 to 10 reps and go through two rounds of that exercise.
So when you say stand up as explosively as possible, that's pushing on your front leg there to launch yourself up as much as possible.
Yeah. So essentially we want the front leg to be the primary worker of the exercise, and the rear leg is just there for support, like stability and support. So we don't want the rear leg to overly contribute to too much force. It's going to contribute somewhat to the exercise, but the front leg, we want the front leg driving through the floor. Imagine you've got a rocket up your backside and trying to stand as explosively as you can.
Okay, that's a good way of putting it. And then it's 8 to 10 on one leg, 8 to 10 on the other leg?
Yeah, and then with that, obviously, because you're doing individual legs, by all means, if you want to take like a micro rest between legs, you know, so 15 to 30 seconds, just shake your legs out, swap over, get yourself back into position again, and then go again, and go from there. And then we want to take anywhere between 2 to 3 minutes of rest before we complete that sequence again.
Okay, great.
So for our secondary exercise, we want to target more specifically the hamstrings and the glutes, whereas the first one is a little bit more quad-focused. I'm going to start with what's known as a bodyweight Romanian deadlift. This is key in terms of the positions we hold on the bike, developing glute strength, hamstring strength, in terms of being able to hold our positions. So we want to, from a standing position, initiate the movement by pushing our bum backwards. So our hips move back and we naturally bow down. And as we stand up, we think about pushing our feet through the floor and pushing the hips up and through, so we come up into a standing position again. So it's a little bit more technical. It does take some time getting used to, but once mastered, is a golden nugget of an exercise in terms of how you can continue to load and progress that for performance on the bike.
That's not one I've actually heard of or thought to do before, so that's a really good eye-opener for me. I guess I'm going to have to go to the gym and start doing some of this.
It's an eye-opener, especially because your glutes and hamstrings will start to feel like they're being worked like they've never done before, so, and that can be a bit of a real eye-opener for people if you get it nailed. Again, we're going to be targeting a little bit more hamstring glute because they don't get as much love, should I say, you know, in terms of on the bike, we tend to be very quad focused in terms of always pushing. So we're going to target them in a different plane of movement. So it's going to be single leg glute bridge. So we're going to lie down on the floor. We're going to tuck our pelvis under, so we flatten out our lower back onto the ground. So that's firmly pressed into the floor, elevating one leg out in front of us. So we've got a bent knee with the foot flat on the floor. We're just going to push through the heel and try and shoot our hips up to the sky until we get up into a nice, straight, elevated position, lower back down under control, and go again and just repeat those reps on that single leg before swapping over.
Okay, so you're doing single leg exercises.
Single leg, yeah.
Yeah, I guess that is important to say because on the bike, obviously, we're only ever pushing with one leg at a time, right?
Yeah.
So it's important that I guess we focus on those single legs.
Both double and single leg movements are important. Single leg is important in terms of, like I say, that's the sport specificity you're going to get out of the training. And obviously then if we can drive single leg exercises, we can drive a little bit more single leg stability and that force production through those one legs at a time as well. So, and we can bring up any potential deficits then. So if people do work with power and they notice in any power imbalances or coming back from an injury, we can kind of work on those deficits.
Okay, awesome. And then on to exercise number 4. What have you got for exercise number 4?
So this is where we start then. We've worked on the lower body. This is where we want to start working on the upper body and working that from more from a trunk strength and control and stability standpoint through the back and the shoulders. So starting off with the back, and we're just going to do a standing banded single arm row. So we're just going to attach a band out to something secure that's not going to pull over. We can stand with our feet parallel or in a split stance. So we'll step back with the band so there's tension on the band, so that you feel like the band is trying to want to pull you around, and you are then, as from a trunk perspective, are trying to resist that trunk control. So if you imagine, you know, we want to try and maintain a stable back as possible on the bike, we want to resist those movements to get strong through there. So again, 8 to 10 reps from one arm, swap over, adjust the band, create as much tension as necessary, depending on what colour band you may have, and then repeat those reps on the opposite side.
Just before we get into our next exercise, can I ask you, because we've done a lot of discussion with RPE in previous training videos, do you prescribe people do things on RPE when they're in the gym?
Yeah, definitely. So we can work within sort of the S&C world, we can work with RPE and what's known as like reps in reserve, and they've got a very strong correlation together. So if we take ourselves to an RPE of 10, that means there's like zero reps, we've gone to complete failure, and we want to avoid that at all costs. Because the closer we take ourselves to failure, the more fatigue we're driving, and that means we're going to hinder us being able to get on the bike and do our next key sessions of the week. So an ideal nice place to be would be in a sort of RPE 7, RPE 8, so you'd know that you could probably have done like 2 to 3 more reps with what you're doing. So that can take some time to get a bit of a feel for it, know what you're capable of in the gym, testing where your levels are. But even I'd rather someone coming away feeling, thinking they could have done a load more and feeling easy. So I'd rather someone be a mile under than a centimetre over.
Yeah.
Because I'd rather push, knowing I can push someone than push them off the edge of the cliff and go, okay.
You can't come back from that.
Yeah, I can't come back. So I'd rather someone severely undershoot and like, no, okay, cool. Let's give them the confidence to push and see where their levels are.
Yeah, perfect. So start easy and just build your way into it.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, awesome. So then for our next exercise, what have you got for the next exercise?
Cool, just the old good old classic push-up,
okay.
Which is, for a lot of cyclists, quite a humbling experience, I think. Just, you know, even and if the push-up is challenging, just the ability to hold a tall plank position anyway would be key. You know, trunk strength, you know, core strength, shoulder strength and stability. And then we can progress onto different variants of a push-up, whether it's on the knees, whether it's elevated on a bench, because then it takes less load through the upper body and into the arms. So we just find what progression they're going to be key with. Again, you know, shoulder strength and stability, core controls, trunk strength, it's a bit of an all-rounder and can be done anywhere, anytime. Yeah. You know, no matter where you are. So.
A good old push-up. Everyone knows how to do a push-up. You kind of think, hope, and maybe?
It's, like I say, it's very, I think when people come to do it for the first time, like, God, I didn't realise how much strength I'd lost in my upper body. But it's, you know, the ability to support yourself on a bike is key as well. You know, if you hit bumps, rocks, potholes, you know, you don't want to be then thrown over. So having a little bit of body strength is key. And it will also protect you in crashes as well, God forbid, if you do happen to, you know, stack it. So the sixth and final one is more of a core specific exercise. One key one that I like to give is a Copenhagen plank. Key factor with that is, one, we're getting a lot of trunk strength, but we're also targeting the adductors here. And the adductors, like, so your muscles in the inside of your leg, don't often get specifically targeted because we're in a very linear motion pattern. And oftentimes you find cyclists will say, when I'm super fatigued, the inside of my legs are cramping. And because they're just, they're weaker than what their quadriceps are. So key thing with this one would be resting your knee on a bench or a seat and not your ankle. So we talk about a short lever or long lever. The shorter the lever, the easier it is, and we can maintain that position and we can progress. Again, we've got then something to progress you with that exercise.
Alrighty, I think that's probably all good for today. Got 6 exercises there that basically everyone can work on. Just before we do go, let me ask you said about 2 weeks you think of body weight a couple of times a week before people start integrating weights into.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be a case by case basis, but you know, a couple of weeks you're going to see you getting better at the skill of those exercises. The better you get at those skill, the more familiar you become, the better producing some force, so you're getting stronger, you're recovering quicker. So we know then we can start adding a little bit of external load. And start progressing you along the way nicely with that.
Oh, awesome. Thank you so much for your time, your advice.
Thank you for having me.
as we said at the start there, start easy, work your way up. Hopefully you guys get something out of this. If you did enjoy this video and you do get something out of it, make sure to whack a like on it. And if you haven't subscribed to the channel yet, please do. There's plenty more training videos where this came from. So we hope to see you in a future one soon.
Cheers.